overall presentation of the FABLE team's work led by Aline Monsieur. And then we're going to give you a sneak peek at some of the work of three of the country teams. We're going to start with the Nordic region, then we're going to move down to Mexico, and then we'll come back to the United Kingdom. There's two things that I'd like you to take away, at least two things I'd like you to take with these presentations. One is the modeling work of these communities in terms of testing out these pathways. But as important, if not more importantly, the objective of the FABLE team is to provide a tool by which countries can begin to develop pathways. And so the narratives, the transition narratives that originate from these countries that the modeling teams are taking on and trying to understand, really are shifting, I think, the way that we do research away from research, put your papers on a shelf and hope that policy takes it up, to a really much more integrated and iterative relationship between the scientific community and the policy community as we seek to try to understand what options we have to achieve sustainability, equity, and health by 2030.
We still have 2 billion people who do not have regular access to safe, nutritious and sufficient food in 2019.
We are currently over-consuming in sugar, roots, red meat, eggs and milk.
We have 75% of our Mexican population overweight and obese, and 9.4% suffer diabetes. That's a huge burden in public health. So there is a need, an important need, on changing our diet.
The land and food systems are interconnected, so one country can hardly think in isolation from the others. We want to have an integrated approach. We think that all these issues are connected.
There are multiple targets. You can't think just carbon without thinking about biodiversity, other environmental issues and all of that.
We started FABLE to have in each country a team of scientists who can work closely with the police.
What we started doing when we started with this project is to identify all the institutions responsible for implementing public policy related to land and food systems. So this was mostly easy. However, there in the current administration, we have some secretariats who are, for example, the Secretariat of Welfare, who is not traditionally responsible for implementing public policy related to land and food system, but who now is in charge of one of the most ambitious programs for implementing sustainable land and food systems. So the main institutions that we have is the Secretariat of Agriculture and Rural Development, the Secretariat of Health, just because diets are important for the food systems, and the Secretariat of Environment, and several councils and institutions that are under the Secretariat of Environment, who deal with forests, with water, with ecology and climate change, with biodiversity and the NBSAP initiative. And with the natural protected areas. All these institutions are in charge of implementing public policy related. So once that we knew what institutions were important, then we decided to integrate a team of researchers that had specific experience in land and food systems, or that had been government officials in these institutions, or were advisors. For example, the people who is underline is people who have been in office either as a government official, a high rank of government officials in the environment institutions, or they have been working as advisors of secretariats. So this is really important for us, because from here, what we did is to have an idea of how things move in Mexico, how a public policy is implemented, a little bit of how public policy is created.
We're going to have an increase of greenhouse gas emissions to 2050. A change to sustainable food production means that we'll have definitely a significant reduction of the national greenhouse gas emissions.
We announced a new target of trying to achieve net zero greenhouse gas emissions by 2050 in June this year, and now that's now embedded in law. There is a new ambition to reduce our emissions over the next 10 years by more than two-thirds. A lot of this real push to show that the UK is increasing its emissions in climate change mitigation is because it wants to be seen as a leader and to set example for other major economies, particularly in the lead up to hosting the next UN climate summit in Glasgow next year.
it comes to transforming to sustainable food systems, we kind of identified what we call the big four. A sustainable food system should be based on a more local food production and also provide some self-sufficiency. We definitely need for kind of in a sustainable scenario, decrease our red meat consumption and increase actually legumes and nuts consumption.
We only have three countries from Africa in the consortium currently. So, and that's true that this is one of the regions where we expect the most drastic change in the food and land systems in the next decades. I think that the main way to make that better in the future would be to expand and to include more countries from Africa in our consortium.
FABLE does help link the UK ambitions to other countries' ambitions, and it also allows this explanation of different trade-offs and challenges in trying to meet multiple goals at the same time.
The key element is this globally consistent long-term national pathways. If we are more people allowed to interact with such tools or around these tools, so that could be also something just to feed the debate, to launch the debate during some stakeholder workshop. It's not always the final results which are interested, but these tools allow to also bring the discussion into, I think, a constructive way.
We realize that we share more with other countries, challenges and opportunity areas. And with that collaboration, we have been able to really keep us as neutral as possible, to be open to all other, to other options. So I think that this collaboration between teams and to have a diverse team in each of the nations is really important.